Hello, my name is Jenny Varmier. I'm from Potto project, and in this video is a part of a series on dimensional analysis. In this presentation I will discuss what led to dimensional analysis in general and Buckingham method in particular, what are the basic units in the relationship to the number of dimensionless group. I also explain what are the system and the way to get dimensionless group. I also will show example. In the dimensional analysis, or the reason that we got to dimensional analysis, it was a realization that some phenomena are controlled by the dimensionless group. For example, Mach discovered that some phenomena like the oblique shock and other phenomena are controlled by the Mach number, that is the relationship or the ratio between the speed of fluid to the speed of sound. From a mathematical point of view, Nusselt discovered that some dimensionless group appear in the governing equation, and therefore they are the one who control the situation. Other people were looking for some kind of universal units, because we have all kind of method that we were using, and they were looking for some universal units. What are the basic units? The basic units are the units that all other units are made from. It's similar to the periodic table, so to speak. For example, if we have the basic units that we will use, it will be time, length, and mass. So using Newton's second law, F equal to ma, the mass times the acceleration, which is the mass times the length over time square, will be equal to the force. So force will be made out of this thing. On the other hand, if you want to build a system, which is different system, where we're using the force, the length and time, then the mass will be a function of using Newton's second law as F over A equal to M, then the mass will be made out of force unit time the time square over the length. These basic units that we see here are related to the number of groups, according to Buckingham method. This table is taken from Basic of Fluid Mechanics, published by Potto project. And in this book, in this table, we have several units. We have the mass, we have the length and time. That's the typical thing. Now, the temperature also added here, because in some sense it is, and in some molecular sense it is not, where the temperature is actually the velocity related to the velocity square. So there is dispute, but regardless to this point, that will be our typical units that we will be using in fluid mechanics. If we apply dimensional analysis to other area, they might have some other basic units, like the electrical current and the amount of illumination or amount of light that we have. If we have chemical reaction, we have another basic unit, which is the molecular or the amount of substance. It was postulated in a previous video that the ratio of the volume of the wood in the tree to the total to the volume of the tree, as if the trunk was straight post going all the way to the top, that means the diameter times the length, it will be a function of the height and the diameter. Therefore, we have two parameters that controlling the problem. And both of these parameters have the same basic units, length. Therefore, we have 2 minus 1, and we have the number of dimensionless group that we got, which was L over D or D L over H or H over D. And we have the amount of dimensionless group, which was 1. Buckingham extended, and what basically he suggests, that the number of parameter n minus the number of basic units will give us the number of dimensionless group. Of course, in reality, that's not really true, but this is give us the minimum of dimensionless group that we will have. One of the most typical things that we using in dimensional analysis is that maybe the most celebrated example is a flow in a pipe. A flow going on a horizontal pipe from one side to the other side. We have a length, we have the diameter. So the length and the diameter, of course, the viscosity as is the measure of the resistance of the liquid to the flow, and the velocity. The density is something that is not really intuitive, but if we throw it into the mix, we will have six parameters, and we have in this case three dimensionless group, which is the length, the mass, and the time, and therefore we should have three basic dimensionless group as 6 minus 3 equal to 3. There are basically at least three different methods to calculate the dimensionless group. The most intuitive method is multiplying all the parameters one by another in some kind of power. And let's call it A, B, C, D, E, F. Some people attribute this idea to Reynolds, and that was probably the method that I learned in my elementary fluid mechanics class. This method yield five equations and five unknown, as one of this power can be arbitrary, and then we're going to have this thing. Some other people about 40 or 50 years ago suggest a different method. They say, let's stack one variable or one parameter in every that will represent one basic dimension. For example, the diameter will present the length, the density will present the mass, the velocity will present time. Of course, the density have also length, but we use it as a representative of the mass, and because we can multiply it by some coefficient. So if we want to do find the dimensionless group of any of the rest of the parameter, we'll take for example the length, that will be the length, time, the diameter, the density, and u in this thing, and that for the method that was suggested by Rayleigh will be simplified to get three different equations and three different unknown. In this method, what we're doing, we're taking the length, raising it in power of A, the density, raise it in power of B, the diameter in power of B, the density in power of C, and the velocity in power of D. The density is M over L U square. And then we're collecting all the terms that we're going to get in the length. So, for example, the length in power of A will give us A, D will give us B, and the third term, the density, will give us minus 3C, and the velocity will give us plus D. In the mass, we will have another equation, which will be C equal to 0, where C is the mass in power of C. And therefore, we have this thing. Automatically, we can conclude the density is not going to appear in this dimensionless group. And the same thing about the time. Therefore, we're getting is D over L, or in power of B. And we choose, since B is arbitrary, we get it D over L or L over D, depending on our choice. The same thing we can do for the pressure. We have the pressure time D, time rho, and time U. All of them are in different power. And we can collect all the variables. So what we will have is in the length we have minus a, because we have the l in the bottom, and in the d we'll have plus b, minus 3c, which one we done it before, and plus d that we have it, and the same thing we do for the mass, and etc. If we solve all this equation, we're going to get square root of rho u over square root of the pressure in power of d. Since d is arbitrary, if we choose 2, we get rho u square over the pressure difference, and that is Euler number. The same thing we can do for the viscosity. If we notice that we always repeating the same process all over again and again, since we're repeating it, some people suggested that these things can work as a matrix, and that's actually the third method that we use. Typically is not taught in fluid mechanics and it's used by mathematicians. If we do it in this process, we're going to get again three equations, and we get d rho u over mu in power of d. Since d is arbitrary, we choose 1 and we get d rho u over mu, which is Reynolds number. What we receive now, we receive three dimensionless group. We have dimensionless length, we have Euler number and Reynolds number. It's three dimensionless group. In real world, we have six or more dimensionless parameter, but it is only indication what it is. So the question is, why are we teaching Buckingham method when clearly just providing the minimum that needed? The reason that we do it is because it is taught in many fluid mechanics classes, and it's a must know if you want to pass the exam. In fact, it's also used in professional engineering. It's really useful only and only when we don't know the governing equation. In fact, when you really want to solve problem, most of the situation is that you know the governing equation, then using Buckingham method will defeat the purpose, and you must not use it. Otherwise, you're going to get wrong results and wrong experiment. Thank you for listening, and I hope you enjoyed this video and the whole series.